has to deal with the prince of this world, right? The prince of this world, Satan or Satana, had to deal with the prince of this world. And then he says that all power, all sultan, all authority. Now we say sultane to say a civilization, right? A civilization. And that's also interesting right there, because what we're learning here in the Torah portions is not just some historical art and facts. And no, it's more of civilization as we get to walk in this, as we walk in it in a new and a living way in Yeshua HaMoshiach, and through the cross, recognizing the Meskel, the true Meskel of His Majesty, of His Divine Majesty. So now, the summary of this is, first is the blessing of Musa, and then secondarily is the death of Musa. Now that's kind of very interesting when we start to look in the book of Hebrews, or the Melikita Ibrawian, or the Epistle to the Hebrews, and we find out that concerning the lion of the tribe of Judah, and the tribe of Judah, you understand, the tribe of Yehuda. It is a very interesting connection there as well. And if we get a chance, we're just mentioning it right here so that others, being guided by the Ruach HaKodesh, can study up on it. And Yah willing, we can also present perhaps a teaching on that as well. So where we're at right now is I want to look up a particular verse. We actually was touching on fire and water because of the Rastafari Kebele, or Kabbalah, of Jah time. Kind of a brief vid we put up there just on Jah time, because some ask these questions. They're like, well, how could God, in a sense, manifest? You understand? But we have Yeshua. He is the God-man, or He is God manifested in the flesh. And we cannot get to the Father's house, or to the Father, to Abba, only in and through Yeshua HaMoshiach. So He's like the star gate. He's like the gateway of that. Now, let's just look this up right here, when it says how death reigned from Adam to Moses. Because when we think about, oh, if we look at it in the Old Testament sense, it might be like, oh man, that's Moses, like when we said about Moses, civil rights is affirmative action. We talked about, and Moses touching on, Negro civil rights and everything is dead. A lot, all that is dead. You understand? But a lot of folks don't want to recognize that it's dead, In other words, it's like the Old Testament to the New Testament. That whole link right there, you understand, that it was given to the Jews, or to the Yehuda, it was given to I and I, but how we dropped the ball, and how in grace Yeshua has been sent, in the sense, to the team, what I mean, almost on the spiritual level, greater than a so-called Michael Jordan. You understand, when you really think about it, when you overstand it. But here in Romans chapter 5 verse 14, it says, nevertheless, death reigned. Now, it uses the word reign. And it's interesting that if we look at the word reign, reign doesn't mean, and death was around, and death was in town, and but it said death reigned. I mean, you have to just think about the significance of that word. You understand? What is death? Who is death? You understand? Death is the enemy. You see, death is the enemy. The Bible says death is the last enemy to be destroyed. You understand? And this is why we preach and proclaim the good news of the King of Kings and His Christ. You understand? Both because it is true, and because of the demonstration in and through Kedemawi Haile Selassie. You understand? Of the God-man, of Yeshua HaMoshiach, that true testimony in a time. You understand? It's like, unless God has shortened the days, not even the very Chruyan would be saved. Right, unless He has shortened those days and those times. That's the visitation of Kedemawi Haile Selassie, shortening those days. But we have to be wise to salvation ourselves, because we are partakers on that level, or we are to be. We are given the choice. You understand? The choice is put before you. Moses gave the choice in a couple of Torah portions previously, right? We just went over that again. That choice is there. You understand? Between blessing and between curse, between life, hewet, and between death, mot. You understand? So mot, and that's interesting, mot, because mot was a Canaanite, deity, what they'll call God, right? And false pseudo emanation, New World Order, zeitgeistism. The zeitgeistism basically is all about that. The zeitgeist, because you have poltergeist, you know. The zeitgeist is the gateway to the poltergeist, if you understand it. This is why we see, you know, spiritually and in reality what's going on. The earth is like turning into hell. You understand? It's turning into Sheol, the Duat, the underworld. It's like the underworld has become in this world. People say it's a myth and this and that, but then why are so many people, you understand, working so hard, consciously and unconsciously, to manifest a myth? You understand? It's a great shortcoming to think that the ancients were stupider, you understand, were like dumber than us in a sense, especially when we look at the scriptures and even so-called mythologies and so forth and so on. And then look at the situation that faced us right now. Mm-hmm. And the interesting thing is that most folks, they already know about, you know, now with information going to and fro, they already know about these things. But in spite of what they know, as Echitemi says, you know, they continue to do what they do. So nevertheless, right, death reigned from Adam, right? So then we try to make not light of it, but basically like Adam, you know, to Musa, to Mashu, to Moses. So wait, hold on for a moment. But Moses died. How and why could Moses die if death only reigned from here to there? Let's ask that question. How could Moses die? You understand? But then we read in Jude, in Yehuda, in Yehuda's Melikit, in Yehuda's epistle, his didactic, his teaching letter, you have to make it autodidactic. You have to self, you understand, learn and self-teach, self-learn, and self-be taught, you understand? In this, he speaks in his one-letter epistle, his letter, one-letter, right? Not one letter, single letter, but one single chapter, let's put it like that, called Jude. Right, he says that there was some wrestling, it seems like, over the body of Moses. What? The body of Moses? Why would there be wrestling over the body? It reminds me of what we hear in the bone lies concerning Haile Selassie, when we hear about these bone lies. Some people believe it. Well, I guess that's their right there, because there's a choice. You understand, of truth or a lie or whatnot, you know, and they choose to believe the lie, or they've been hoodwinked and bamboozled to believe. You know, they'll say, well, look, there's His Majesty's tomb or whatnot like that. You understand? But everything we've heard about it has been really a bone lie. You understand? I mean, the bone's too big, gold teeth in the mouth, not the right size, you know, and then the evidence of the living man that we've had since then to now. You understand? And there's a few pictures which are very, not even just, coincidental. Yeah, I mean, it's a coincidence, but more and more we find to be very compelling. You understand? But then again, we say our faith is not based on the picture. You understand? Our faith is based on the fact, both the fact in our own walk and in our own life. You understand? The gnostikoi, in other words, that you know, that you know, that you know. You understand? But what about death reigning from Adam to Moses? It would make it seem that, well, after, and this is New Testament, Romans 5:14, that after Moses, right, nobody else should have died. Could it be that there was a possibility that no one else had to die, but because of that, let's call it the golden calf incident? You understand? Perhaps after the golden calf incident, that more ones, people died, or death still somehow reigned. But then what about this wrestling over Moses' body that we read about? Let's see if we can get this scripture over here, right? Get this scripture over here. Okay, could we just get, you know, just getting into this. right now, right here, right now. Kobe was gonna perhaps wait a little bit, just kind of just first keep the Sabbath or remember the Sabbath, because that's the key word there, remembering. You see, remembering, it's a mental ascent, because we have to be born again from above. You know what I'm saying? Nicodemus didn't really understand that too well, and that's why Christ said, you being a master of Israel, you understand, a Rebbe of Israel, you don't understand these things. You know, wow, that's deep. You know, he recognized how deep the situation was for our first century people. But here it says something interesting in verse 8. It says, this is the apostate teachers are described. Because a lot of ones out there teaching or talking about even Rastafari, different things, but not according to the testimony of His Majesty. So how can we trust them if they're not in tune with His Majesty's own clearly revealed revelation? Should we? I mean, it might be interesting, curious, but we have to really learn to take that as, I won't say entertainment, but you have to be very careful. You understand? Very careful, you know, not to have any fellowship. You understand? So apostate teachers describe. It says, likewise also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. They speak evil of His Venerable Majesty. They speak evil of Him. What evil do they do? Did He do? You understand? What evil? Why they do these things? Well, we might not be able to ask these and those and interrogate them or inquisition them or whatnot just yet. But verse 9 says, yet Michael, the archangel, right, the leak malaikt, when contending. So Michael, the angel, was contending with Diabolos, with the diabolical one. He disputed. Right? He disputed about the body of Moses. Right? So he disputed, but he durst not bring against him a railing accusation. He didn't bring against him. So the context of this is that Michael, the leak malaikt, was contending with Diablos, right, concerning the body of Moses. Wow. Concerning the body of Moses. There's something I want to just look at right here, the body of Moses, right? And you remember His Majesty's autobiography, the Uhlendorf translation, right? Now, it's interesting. I put Moses and body in the search, and only two places of Moses and body. One is in Numbers 9 and 6, right? 9 and 6. Okay, that's a different place right there, and it's this area in Jude 1 and 9. Now, it's interesting, I think His Majesty's autobiography, I think it talked about sepulcher, sepulcher, right? Let me just look up sepulcher, like nobody knows where his, burial place is. No one knows where, it says something about to this day, nobody knows where Moses, I think there's a verse actually that speaks to that, like, or his eye did not dim. I think it has, it's in, let's see, Deuteronomy 3 and 7. It says, and Moses, Deuteronomy chapter 34, excuse me, and 7, it says, and Moses, 120 years, just like this 2012. Right, His Majesty, Kedamawi Haile Selassie, is, right, 120 years this year. That's why the enemy came up and tried to deflect that. You understand? Perhaps in ignorance, the person, but definitely not those who are driving that, those ones to, you know, just go so hard out against that. Why does that offend the spirits who have deceived you? This is what we would ask them. But Moses was 120 years old when he died, it says, right? His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. Now, if I recall in Edward Uhlendorf's translation, the autobiography of His Imperial Majesty, he has something very cryptic there. I don't know if we could find that. You know, let's see if we could find that. Edward Uhlendorf said something. We want to get the exact reference so ones can then, you know, check it out. Negerus in the Zihu Yohonen. They can ask that question like the Bereans in Acts of the Apostle, chapter 17, verse 11. It says on page, it's actually the postscript page, book one, before the translator's introduction and after the translator's preface. It says, since this preface was written about more than 6 months ago, the death of Emperor Haile Selassie occurred on 27th August 1975. While he was denied a proper burial by those who now rule Ethiopia, and the place of his interment remains unknown, the serious organs of the World Press have published obituaries of a depth and size not previously accorded to any other African leader. A memorial evensong and presentation of garter banner attended by his son and heir and an impressive congregation took place at St. George's, Windsor Castle, and a memorial tribute was offered by the Earl of Avon. Or Avon, actually, in the American way, but Avon. It's interesting because there's a Beta Avon, too. A-V-E-N. Check it out in the scriptures, right? It says, thus a life has ended of which, like Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 34. So Edward Uhlendorf, right, he sees in His Majesty some definite comparison or likeness, especially with Deuteronomy chapter 34, which is the Simchat Torah portion. And he quotes, no man knoweth of his sepulcher, right, to this day. So we're in the chapter, right, but let's see if we can get this particular chapter right here. It says, no man knows of his sepulcher, right, to this day. So what they've done recently with the bone lie, right, is try to say, oh, look, now we have a place. They found his bones under this or that or so forth and so on. They don't want you to look at the controversy. You understand? That basically throws credible doubt, you understand, on the lie that they're trying to tell us. You understand? Because they know that the biggest thing that Rastafari always had, you understand, with them is like concerning the death, alleged death of His Imperial Majesty of Ketamawi Haile Selassie, is that, well, you don't have no evidence. You haven't had evidence for like 30-something years, and now you want to just act like, wow, so forth and so on. But yet there's a lot of credible evidence from different sources, even some sources which are not inclined to say anything favorable of His Majesty or for Ionized Rastafari, that have given and still are giving various testimonies to the contrary. Yovas. So ones have to really just check that out for themselves, right? So no man knoweth of his sepulchre to this day. And until his last days, his eye was not dimmed, nor his natural force abated. Those of us who really knew the man and the king will long mourn the passing of Haile Selassie. For there will not arise in Ethiopia anyone quite in his image. Well, that's questionable there, because we as children, you see, we as his children, as Rastafari, we are in his image and after his likeness. Let's recognize that. But this was written in November 1975 by Edward Uhlendorf, and otherwise it is very, very it's very, very interesting, and it's relevant with what we're saying right here. So check it out in the book one of His Majesty's autobiography, the English translation. Now, why do we feel the need to check that out and compare that? Well, for a couple of different reasons, because there's this New Testament thing in the book of Jude, and Jude is Judah. Jude is Judah. And let's recognize that. So we say Judas, there's Judas. Judas is Judah too. You understand? When we trace it to its etymological root. Now, the difference is there was one who was the betrayer, right, who was called Askarotawi, Iscariot, of the cities, right? He liked the city life, right? You know, like the Babylonian dread, to be big boat y'all. You understand? To drive around and around in circles and be big boat y'all, right? So that's that kind of mentality, if you would understand it. That betrays, truly, Rastafari. You know what I'm saying? Pato Bantan had a song where he... my name is Pato Bantan. This is my opinion. And in that, I think one of the original versions of it, he touches on that. And I think there's a connection right there. But here's what happened. Now, Michael, the archangel, is disputing, right, or contending rather, with the devil and disputed about the body of Moses. So was the devil disputing about the body of Moses? Was it... Michael that was disputing the, now here's where you need to get into the, you know, either the Septuagint or get into what we'll call the more original and more accurate, more than original, the more accurate languages. You understand? Nowadays the Bible's being translated into all different sort of ways and dumbs it down so that person can get what the translator wants you to get, but not what the true author. You understand? The author and the finisher or the completer of our faith, of our hymenote. All right? Now let's go right here to Jude verse 9. It says, Ye melaikt aleka Mikael gin ka diablos gar bete karakaragize sile muse siga si negagar. So the sense is that they both were in some level of words, you know, words passing back and forth and different ideas. Like, for example, the world has this idea of what happened to Kedamawi Haile Selassie, our Godfather and King of Kings, to Abba. And we, you understand, know the truth, right? As Rastafari, as true and faithful children, we know the truth because of the word, because of his testimony. All right. Now it goes on to say, "Gita, you guess it, alo, inji, ye sidbin ferd sinagro al deferem." This is interesting that he was not. It says, but he durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, The Lord rebuke thee, or Adonai, you guess it, in other words, Adonai, Gita Kurios, the Lord, the master, the real boss, Yeshua, right? Rebuke, the Lord of Lords, rebuke you, the Lord rebuke you. All right, now this is interesting. When we look at the bone lies, you understand, the bone lies. So we have Moses' death, all right? We have the Simchat Torah. We have Moses' death, right? And we have the revelation of his majesty and the likening from a third, you could say a third source or from another source. It's not one of our sources, Edward Uhlendorf. I mean, very credible source as well. You understand? That even complements, you understand, and corroborates our evidence. You understand? But who will accept our report? You know, in other words, who will, as it says, believe our report? You understand? And that's interesting too, because that's what the Ethiopian eunuch was reading as well. And that's concerning the main idea here concerning Yeshua HaMashiach. You know what I'm saying? But it goes on to say, In the Zihagin Yemayauk Utin Hulu Yisad Debalu. Right, these kind of folks, right, who are like Diablos, the Diablo Soch of Yazare Winu, right? But these speak evil of those things which they know not, which they have no gnosis of. They have no gnostikoia up. They have no gnosis up. So they're going to speak evil, like those trolls on the internet that speak evil of Ayin Rastafari, of His Majesty, of Ethiopia, of the Beta Israel, of, you know, of everything they don't know about. You know what I mean? They speak evil of. But what does the scripture say? It says, I am Rome in the Leilacho, in Sisoch. Befit retacho, be miyauk uta hulu, be arsu yitefalu. It says, but these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally. Right, what they know according to the fitret or fitretacho, according to the their creation, their natural. You understand what they should know in that sense naturally. You understand by nature. You know, just as just natural. Rastafari tell them, right? Just natural. But fitretacho, but my yaukut, but my yaukut, but my yaukut hulu, but arusu yitefalu, as brute beast. Right, as brute beasts. It's interesting, Bamarinya, because in Bamarinya says, I am Rome, in other words, mind, right, overstanding, I am Rome, and mind, and overstanding, and I am Rome in the Leilacho, as they don't have, you understand, that they don't have, like mindless, another way like saying, as they are without any mind, right, or overstanding. In Sisoch, they're like animals, right? They're like animals without any, like, any mental acuity, if you want to say, without any, just mindless. It's like a lot of the things that we're witnessing in these last days of the Gentile world dominion and the apostate church age. You're like mindless folks. It says, in those things, they corrupt themselves, but that corrupt themselves really is very much softened, very much, because it's be'erusu, and in it, right, or in him, yitefalu, right? It means that they destroy, they're lost. You understand? Not just that they corrupt, but they are lost. In other words, this is the era where King James, with the sin of Jacob, to say, because James means Jacob, King Jacob. Right, the Gentile European King Jacob, you overstand how what the word says that the sin of Jacob or the sin of James Bible, King James, well, not, it shouldn't be named that, but that's what it's named. It should be really called the William Tyndale Bible, you overstand, but he was martyred, you overstand, one of our Christian brothers, right? But it says right here, Woyo Lacho, right? Woyo Lacho. Right, woe to them, or woe is for them. Woyo, woyo, woyane is for them. Bek ayel men get hey dawalina. Sila madem wezim, le bella arm, right? Sihitet arasachuin asalfo seti tawal. Bek orim mekawem tef towal. Wow, for they have gone in the way of Cain, the way, right? We are in the way of the Moshiach, Yeshua, our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But they are in the way of Bek ayel menged, in the way of Cain, right? They have gone and ran, it says, and they ran, right? They ran, it says, greedily. Right, ran greedily, right, after the era of Balaam, after the era of Balaam for a reward, right? Now, Bamarinya, it says something, let's see, Demoezim le Balaam sihitet rasachuin asalfo setitewal, that they, in a sense, have betrayed themselves, right? They kind of betrayed themselves, their own head and their own self, right? For the wages, right? Of the era, right? Of the era of Balaam. Remember Balaam? We talked about Balaam, and we spent some time on Balaam because it comes up in other places within the Wengel in the Good News, and further in the Hadith Kidan. In order to understand, well, what is the context of it, You understand? So we can see what Yeshua is showing us in its right in its right context. So we have to understand what the so-called backstory of the Old Testament. Because if you come in like a Gentile, in other words, like many of us have been, even though we're Beit Israel, the diaspora, so-called black Jews, we come like Gentiles from a Gentile, white, Western, Eurocentric, Protestant, Catholic misunderstanding and mistranslation. You understand? That also has that great offense against God, that racism. You understand? And not everyone is racist. That don't believe that. Because racism has to do with like the wealth and the power and what God has given freely to all. Some say this is all ours, even take what's yours, you understand? And then put up a phony counterfeit racial kind of a thing, you understand, to steal what is ours and to steal that glory, you understand, from the black man, woman, and child. And that's what it comes down to. Some are beginning to see it a little bit more than less. But it says, Bekorei Mek'awem, right? And in the rebellion, it says, this is gainsaying, but really this is more like the opposition of Kore, also Kore or Korah, right? In the Old Testament, it is K, K-O-R-A-H. Here it's C. O-R-E, like core. That's interesting because they have some Negro thing called core. You know that. I just thought about that. I think I might have thought about that before, but I'm just noticing. Don't they have something called core? Some Negro thing called core, C-O-R-E. You understand? I remember I had a aunt that had the name Cora, but that was, you know, that's interesting there too. I got to meditate on that. But here I'm noticing how this is linking with the 40-year feast. I mean, the 40-year the 40 years in the wilderness. My eye just glanced on the next verse here, verse 12, right? And verse 12 says, in the Z, ka inantegar si gabezu, befikar gwebejachu, in the idifnacho, in the erenyoch yale ferhat rasachuin yitebkalu, benefas yetewesedu wicha, ye lele bacho demenawoch fre ye maya feru hulet gize ye motu ka kane seracho yete nek elu bebega ye dereku zafoch. These are spots in your feast of charity, in the love feast, the agape feast, what we call the Ital Sup, when we really once again become orientated to His Majesty's will and to His good news. We'll recognize the true meaning of the Ital Sup. These are our feasts, right? And when they feast with you, when these kind of folks feast with I and I, feeding themselves without fear, without any sort of respect, any sort of reverence, right? It says clouds, they are without water, right? Clouds, they are without water, right? Carried about of winds, like hot air, right? Trees whose fruit withereth. You understand? So they don't have no fruitfulness when you look at, well, how they are ministering. You understand? What is the real fruit of that? Without fruit, twice dead. Remember, there's two deaths. It speaks about that in Revelation. There's the first, a natural, fleshy death, and then there's the death of the soul. You understand? In the Gehenna Isat was called hell, but actually the flames and the fire. All right. Twice dead, plucked up by their roots, right? Twice dead, plucked up by their roots. Now it's interesting how this is gonna go forward into Enoch, right? Raging waves of the sea foaming out their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Now, many under the racist regime of Satan and white supremacy have, you know, linked in the black people thing. Even the Mormons, they have their original theology basically considers us to be these children of Cain. So that's some of the momentum behind this whole presidential thing going on in this very season. This is the season that we're in. So just for the record, that's the very same thing. So when you look at Obama coming from the so-called Trinity or the black revolutionary or liberation, so-called, right? And then you look at Romney now on the other, he's like the polar opposite. You know, this is why we live in very, very interesting times, right? But it says, Yegeza no rachuin arefa, ye daraku chekan, ye bahir ma'ibel, dik dik chalama lezalalem, ye te tebekalacho, ye mina karatatu, kawakabita nacho. Wow, this is really interesting right here. The dick dick, very thick. You remember the Honorable Elijah Muhammad? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he spoke about the triple darkness, and there's been a lot of reasoning and debate on one amongst the Nation of Islam, the Black Muslims, and our more Ishmaelitish leaning brothers and sisters, the true Ishmael, the true Black Arabs or Hebrews who are Arabic. Speaking to our brothers and sisters coming from the Islam, those who are members of the Hebrews, when it says to Abraham, talking about the seed people, you understand, his seed, you understand, and we have to recognize who's who in that. But he talked about the triple darkness. He often talked about how Black, you know, the Black man is being saved from this triple darkness, this triple, the dick chalama. We see this dick chalama right now. You understand? I mean, it's like you talk to someone, you try to reach them, you see what, you know, what's going on out there in the world, and it's like they're in a triple darkness. No matter you turn the light up more and more, it's almost like the darkness kind of like doesn't receive the light. It's like the light is so bright, but there's an extra layer of darkness right there, the chalama or the shadow, really from the shadow state. But the chelema, the chelema, right? The shadow state. And it says in verses 14 and 15, right? And this now links with Hanok, right? Just before the flood, right? It says, Ka'adam jemro sebatenya yehone Hanok ineho gita behululai indifarit behatia tenetim siladaregut Silahat ya tenya seracho hulu ametenyochim hat ya tenyoch beersulai siletenagaru sile chikena neger hulu hat ya tenyochin hulu india wekis ka a elafat kedu sanugar metito al below le nezi degmo tin beat. Now, this is really two verses from the Ethiopic. We recognize from the Royal Amharic of His Majesty's Bible, we recognize this is really one verse. And you can see that the idea is through and through, but they separated at the comma of his saints. But it reads in the King James, and Enoch or Hanok, we say Ethiopic Enoch, also the seventh from Adam. He was the seventh in that line. Now the number eight is also very, very interesting. And we speak about like the Og, the Od. You understand? Within the true Ethiopic Kabbalah, there is a link right here. He was the what? The seventh, right? And then how many were saved? Eight. In Noah's, in the Noah, Anoch, you know, Anok, Ankh, when we look at it Ethiopically, right? And that also is number eight, and the eight also symbolic of the mother and the Merkab, the ark, and Kedistin Glomardium and the church. You understand, you begin to understand that connection there. But Enoch, also the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, right, saying, behold, right, Adonai cometh with 10,000s of his saints. This is interesting when we look at this whole UFO thing from another level, and don't get caught up in the whitewash. You understand? It's almost like every time they're trying to like sell a movie or something like that, so they kind of spin it. You understand? And the truth is like kind of like, you know, it's like the details. You have to get into the details, right? So it says that Adonai, he cometh with 10,000s of his saints, of his holy ones, right? Speaking of those who are now, but moreover those who were. You understand, as well as those who are to come to execute judgment, the written judgment. You understand? The written judgment. these, all the saints have this right. And we touch on that in the other psalm. We'll talk about the written judgment. You over the night, we can end this nightmare. And the righteous generation will be of those to end the nightmare. You know what I'm saying? It's whether we are that righteous generation or not. You know, it really depends on, you know, we see a 40-year generation wandering in the wilderness, Yehovah's, and this is what this time, this season, this moed, right, this Baal, or the moedim, Baalat, right, the appointed times is all about, right, the appointed time, that's what the word meod, or I mean moed, actually refers to. So to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him, have spoken against the Father, have spoken against the Son, you understand, have spoken against the righteous, you understand, to persuade them. And brothers and sisters, I'll say that this verse here, this area here, is like kind of part of what I'll call my kingdom mind programming. That if we're going to put out a message out there, it's about executing this judgment. You understand? Even in spirit, giving them a fourth taste, right? Execute judgment and to convince all that are ungodly. And that's in preaching the Wengel, the good news, not for guilt trips, you understand, but for repentance. You understand? To call ones to repentance. Right, convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds. Now, when we was reading it, it doesn't say kufuoch. Notice it doesn't say kufuoch. It says bechatia tenetim siladargut silechatia tenya seracho hulu amet enyochim chatia tenyoch beersulai siletenagaru sile chikena. Negar hulu chat yatenyo chin hulu indi wek is. Right? To do what? To, and that word wek es, mok es, is interesting too, because you find that in John's, Johannes's Wengel, in John's Good News. Right? You find that in John's Good News. Let's go right here. So you can understand why some of these things we've preached on before, to kind of like preposition the spiritual resources, right? Prepositioning the spiritual resources. So we've touched on it before. Among some who get it, and you know, depends on like, you know, we're different spiritual ages, in other words. You understand? So as ones come to grow up, they would get certain things quicker. Yovas, and some of y'all even know where I'm teaching and preaching, some where I'm going with it, because like you're on the network. Right, but John chapter 16, right, verses 7 to 11 says there's a threefold work, that Trinity, Selassie, Salus Kedus, a threefold work, right, of the Menfes, of the Ruach, towards the world, towards the Alem. And see, we have to understand this so we're in the world and not of the world. You understand? We're in the seclorum, but we're not of the seclorum, because we are co-laboring. We're not just laboring by ourselves, but we are co-laboring with the Moshiach Yeshua, with the Messiah Jesus, the Messiah Jesus. We are co-laboring with Christ in his kingly character. And here in chapter 16, right, chapter 16, let's see if we can do this. Okay, chapter 16, verse 7, it says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. I tell you ilnet. You understand? Not telling you no lie. Telling you the ilnet. Telling you the truth. Okay, let's get this right.